A combat veteran Marine died back in 2008, not on the battlefield, but in his sleep in the United States. More than 25 different bottles of prescription pills within his arm's reach. Now, this Marine's brother points blame in one direction, the doctors who wrote all those prescriptions. I want you to watch this piece. It is CNN Pentagon correspondent Chris Lawrence.
Gunnery Sergeant Chris Bacchus survived the assault on Baghdad, a deployment to Afghanistan, and a second tour in Iraq.
What specifically killed your brother?
He stopped breathing. He died because he mixed narcotic drugs.
Jerry Bacchus says by the time Chris went back to Iraq in 2007, he had changed.
He was putting himself in situations where he was exposing himself to potential enemy fire, according to his commander. He was going John Wayne.
He had been hospitalized for anxiety. They suspected traumatic brain injury from an IED, but Sergeant Bacchus kept deploying.
Whenever he had an issue with him, they would increase either the dosage or the potency of the individual pill.
A bomb couldn't kill this Marine, but a bottle did. He died on base at Camp Lejeune. Cause of death, multi-drug toxicity, an accident. The autopsy shows a potent mix of sedatives, opiates, and antidepressants in his system. Officials found 27 bottles of pills in his room, almost all prescribed by military doctors within the past 90 days.
How could a team of doctors that are allegedly working together prescribe all of those things together?
It's a question all the branches have been asking. A recent Army report found one-third of soldiers are taking at least one prescription medication.
Do you think there's been an over-reliance on prescription drugs in the Army?
I think in some cases, yes.
Brigadier General Richard Thomas says the Army set a 30-day limit on new prescriptions and ordered comprehensive case reviews for any soldiers prescribed more than three drugs. It's also trying to promote alternative treatments.
So whether it be acupuncture or biofeedback or yoga therapy, there's a host of other things we can provide to patients to take care of them right, other than narcotics. Now, narcotics still may have a role, but it doesn't have as big a role.
From the Republican Guard.
A former soldier himself, Jerry Bacchus says his brother would still be alive if the military's medical system wasn't swamped by the hundreds of thousands of troops needing treatment.
You're going to give me whatever I need to make me feel better, and you're going to make me go away because there's 1,000 people standing in line behind me that just came off the bus with me.
Wow, Chris Lawrence joining me now live. And Chris, you mentioned how Sergeant Bacchus, he went back, you mentioned two tours, he was in Iraq and also in Afghanistan. When you talk about it, it was 27 bottles ultimately found. Wouldn't, and I don't know how many he was taking at the time when he went back for the second tour, but wouldn't however many, multiple prescription drugs make someone ineligible for going back and fighting a war?
Well, in general, the answer could be no, Brooke. Actually, the Pentagon determined that there were very few prescriptions that would necessarily disqualify someone from deployment. Look, in the issue of fairness, it's tough for these military doctors, these VA doctors. There really are no good drugs out there that deal with the range of emotional and physical ailments that some of these troops come home with. So a lot of times the doctor is mixing and matching to deal with people who have, you know, very serious emotional and physical ailments. You know, add to that the fact that some troops will go to private doctors, so their prescriptions may not show up on their military record. And what could be an even bigger problem, wounded soldiers and Marines trading prescription drugs amongst themselves.
I know, Chris, that ultimately it is these troops who are the ones taking the pills themselves, but is anyone else being held accountable here if we're seeing an uptick in this sort of multi-prescription drug trend?
Well, you're seeing, like we documented with the Army, it's something that all the branches are struggling with and trying to correct. They're all going back The Navy, for example, has this drug give back days in which they say basically bring your drugs back, no questions asked, because they don't want all these prescriptions just sitting out there where people can start to amass this large collection or perhaps give them to other service members who may be in need. And as we mentioned with the Army, they're all trying on the fly now to try to, you know, rein this in somewhat. But again, you know, we've just never seen this level of sustained combat over such a long period of time. And the services, you know, are struggling to keep up with that.
You make the point in your piece saying it wasn't a bomb, it was a bottle, probably bottles that ultimately claimed the sergeant's life. Excellent piece.
And the interesting thing is, yeah. You know, I talked to some medical professionals who said that particular concoction, if you took it, you may be okay.
Really?
But if someone else takes it, it may be toxic to them. That's what they're struggling with in dealing with this problem.
Thank you for bringing us the piece, Chris Lawrence. Yep. In the Pentagon. Thanks.